What do you think of draft dodgers? Is that an alternative to going to Vietnam?
I think what I would wish, you know, would be that they would stay. And for us, and for we pacifists, all seven of us, the most encouraging thing is when the young man says no to Uncle Sam and we'll take the jail sentence. Sorry, old man, you know, you don't get my body, you don't get my mind, you don't get me. I've decided.
You're vice president of a school, the School for Nonviolence. What are you trying to do there?
The reason I started the school is that we try to make available thing, literature and things that give you an idea of what's really going on, and then read books, Gandhi, Huxley, and things that give us ideas, alternatives to violence.
The worst disease in the world today is the fact that men are killing each other, and that's what we're going out to stop. Our vision has to extend way, way beyond that. I mean, I'm not expecting to go on three more marches and have the world all turn over for me. What I think is that you and I need to have a revolution.
That was the amazing thing, was is there was a place and a setting in which you could totally live your ideas and feel you were totally engaged. And so we were just doing workshops night and day, and it would transform people's lives.
I got involved in the seminar in Gandhian Nonviolence taught by Roy Kepler, Ira Sandperl, and Joan Baez, because I was curious.
My concept of nonviolence is very simple. What that means is we feel absolutely certain that the means determine the ends, that is what you do, how you act, is what the kind of world you get. And I really, my hope is that that's really how men really want to live.
By its very nature, it holds out a vision of what the world could be if, in fact, nonviolence were adopted.
The idea that, you know, that you don't just resist, you build the society that you want to be. And that just struck me like a thunderbolt. So to be a draft resistor in that kind of setting, it just seemed natural.
We don't have a graduation and tests and all that, but when they leave the school, they go to jail. No, we've got a goodly bunch of them now.
Oh, oh, freedom. Oh.
Part of nonviolence is a method for dealing with the injustices, the unfairness, the inequalities, the exploitation, without backing up, without giving in, without fight or flight.
And before I'll be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home to...
Well, first I would talk about King's influence on me, which started when I was 16. And I was at a Sealmar conference, which was a big conference of kids from all over the country. And we talked about political issues, social issues. And that year, Dr. King was the guest speaker. And I was dissolved in tears for the whole speech, because I'd read about nonviolence, and I knew about nonviolence, and they were doing it. You know, they were walking in the streets, and they were walking to their freedom, basically. And I was just, I was a mess, you know.
More than 200,000 of them came to Washington this morning in the struggle for equal rights.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
I feel that organized, nonviolent resistance does resist. It is dynamically active. It is passive physically, but it is strongly active spiritually. It is a very strong method. It is a method of the strong man, not the weak man.
Freedom Summer 1964. More than 1,000 volunteers head south in a campaign to register African-American voters.
The eye-opener for me was Mississippi. I was a civil rights worker in Quitman County, Mississippi in 1964. Seeing what was under the covers in America suddenly gave you a whole new perspective.
There are five counties in Mississippi, each at least 57% Negro, in which no Negroes at all are registered.
you know, Quitman County, where I was, there was a 70-year-old woman, walked into the registrar of voters, said, I'm going to register to vote. They arrested her, threw her in jail, tortured her with an electric cattle prod, finally let her out of jail. She walked out the front door of the jail, walked down the block to the registrar of voters office, walked in and said, I'm going to register to vote. You know, there's enormous power in that, you know, and transformative power.
We're willing to be beaten for democracy, and you misuse democracy in the street. You beat people bloody in order that they will not have the privilege to vote.
Courage is inside. It's always in there. It's just waiting to come out. And what you have to do is you have to make a commitment to some principles much larger than yourself, the ideals of justice and freedom and peace. And faith and courage is contagious.
Just the incredible impact that single people taking their lives into their own hands and refusing to accept the conditions that have been enforced on them, just how powerful that was.
No lie can live forever.
Yes, sir. Because
the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards us.
Yes, sir.
Glory, hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
Glory, hallelujah.
Women in Macomb, Mississippi began to talk about the war. They wanted to know why it is that their sons were in Vietnam fighting for allegedly democracy, but you don't have democracy when you get back home.
Send my son to Vietnam.
The beginning of 1965, there were 23,000 American servicemen in Vietnam. Currently, there are about 267,000 U.S. fighting men in Vietnam.
We knew that the war was escalating, and for SNCC, the draft became, and the war became, a significant issue.
Do you think that all colored folks are just second-class food?
The situation and the system that the United States has allows for black people no alternative but to become hired killers. The only way out of a society is through death. They don't have jobs in the ghetto. Their only out is to try and make it in Vietnam. That's the fault of the United States.
And so at that point, SNCC said it's time for us to go ahead and release the statement that African Americans should not engage in the war in Vietnam, period.
We are not only opposed to the war in Vietnam, we are opposed to compulsory conscription. Now, we're against the draft for anybody, black or white.
It went on to say that for all African Americans who are being drafted, we encourage them to take the option of saying, hell no, we won't go.
Hell no, I ain't going. Hell no, hell no,
hell no. I ain't gonna go. I ain't gonna go. Hell no,
hell no. Everybody came out and condemned us. Every civil rights organization, every single person that you could think of. We began to have more and more discussion and dialogue with Dr. King and began to ask when was he going to make a statement against the war in Vietnam. And a year later, he called Stokely and said he had a message that he wanted us to hear.
A time comes when silence is betrayal. That time has come for us in relation to Vietnam.